Hi, I did come a long way today. I think if Marty and Ethan had brought me here from, you know, we could have gotten here faster than United Airlines, but that's okay. Let's get our bearings a little bit. How many of you have seen the film? All right, but a few of you haven't, right? Who hasn't? You've all seen it. So we can talk about the ending. All right, well, we'll see. Anyone here from Texas? All right, one, two, sort of, right? Well, first of all, I do want to thank Kevin and Megan and everyone, you know, here at BU who's brought me up for this. It's a pleasure to be here, especially with Kevin, whose book is also on the table there, which is, you know, I was reading parts of it again on the plane. I had some time. And, you know, it really is an extraordinarily panoramic view of what, you know, Western films have been about from the beginning, and it just was really terrific. All right, so only one person from Texas, so let me just ask another question. Well, let me ask a New England question. How many of you heard of Mary Rowlandson? A few. And how many of you have heard of Cynthia Ann Parker? All right, so we have some things to talk about. Well, I grew up in Rochester, New York, and I'd never heard of Cynthia Ann Parker or Mary Rowlandson. I had heard of Mary Jamison. There's a statue of her in Letchworth State Park that we used to go to frequently. But I did know The Searchers when I was quite young. I saw it, I think, for the first time when I was 7 or 8 at the Archaeo Palace in Rochester. I saw it again at Columbia University about a dozen years later when the great film critic Andrew Saras first taught his introduction to film course in the evenings there, and Searchers was one of the films that he emphasized. And I have to say, even seeing it in those early days, I was very moved by The Searchers. I found it beautiful and powerful and unsettling. You know, even the gunshot wounds, the gunshot sounds, to me are just a little more sharper and authentic than the average Western that I recall when I was a kid. And I wasn't the only one who felt that way about the film. Young Martin Scorsese in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, and young Steven Spielberg in Phoenix, Arizona, and George Lucas growing up in Modesto, California, they all saw the movie in the late 50s. It all became a very formative part of what inspired them to become filmmakers. They all quote from the film, visually and in many other ways, in their own best movies. But the thing is, I had no idea that this frightening, scary, unsettling, beautiful, powerful film had its roots in a true story about a little girl's abduction by Comanches in Texas in the 1830s. And I didn't find out about any of that until I started thinking about doing a book about The Searchers. I really thought I'd be doing your basic making of the movie kind of book, of which there are many. Along the way, you know, John Ford and John Wayne and Monument Valley, that seemed enough material to work with. But it wound up being a lot more than that. The real story begins in East Texas. It begins in a fortified pioneer settlement called Fort Parker in May 1836. And a group of Comanches and other Indians descend on this fortified settlement. And we don't know exactly what triggered the result, but there was a massacre that day. They killed 5 men, they abducted 5 young people, including 9-year-old Cynthia Ann. And she was raised by her captors, and she becomes the wife of a Comanche warrior and the mother of 3 children. Meanwhile, her uncle, a man named James Parker, spends about 8 years looking for her and attempting to find her and the other 4 young people who'd been kidnapped. And James is successful in helping at least retrieve the other 4 over the years, one of them being his own daughter, Rachel, but not Cynthia Ann. She lives with the Comanches for 24 years until she's recaptured in 1860 in another murderous raid. Now, you know, we can talk about this clip a little bit at some point. It is really from the book, The Searchers, but the sense of a fortified area of Comanches descending on it and of what results in the kidnapping of the little girl here has echoes from the original story. Anyway, this second raid, 24 years later, when Cynthia Ann is a Comanche, another group of warriors, if you will, descend on her little community, only this time it's Texas Rangers and it's U.S. Cavalry. They kill all the people around her again and her friends, and they're about to kill a middle-aged woman, Comanche woman, when somebody notices she has blue eyes. And they restore her and her baby daughter, who is with her, to her white relatives. She's kept apart from her Comanche family. I mean, they were only 100 miles between Comancheria and where white settlement was, but it could have been, you know, it didn't matter. There was no way to cross from one to the other. So she never sees her husband or her two Comanche sons again. She dies in misery and relative obscurity. But her surviving Comanche son, a man named Quanah Parker, becomes an apostle of reconciliation between Comanches and Texans. And he helps preserve what's left of the Comanche nation. He invokes the spirit of his dead mother to promote peace between whites and Native Americans. And the two sides of the Parker family, you've got the original Texan side, right, in East Texas, and then you've got the Comanche Parkers, who follow the line from Quanah Parker on down. They're still around. And they hold annual family reunions. There's a Comanche family reunion up in Oklahoma in the old Comanche Kiowa reservation, and they hold that one in early June every year. And there's one in Texas, in East Texas, near the site of the original raid, of the original settlement, and they hold that one in July. And each side sends emissaries to the other side, and they trade a silver bowl each year. They trade it back and forth. It's a very American family, you could say. So once I started backtracking from Hollywood in the 1950s to Texas in frontier times, I began to see something else. And this is really what the book's about. That, you know, Cynthia Ann's story, it's a basic, simple story in the telling. A 9-year-old girl's kidnapped by Comanches, as I said. But what happened is that story's been told and retold by every generation for its own purposes and its own sensibility. And they've changed a few parts here, and they've shaved a little bit there, and they've added some things that clearly weren't true. And each time, to sort of fit their own needs and their own sensibility. And until, you know, the original facts, which are hard to come by, and all the fiction that's been added onto it and interpretation over the years is all kind of smushed together. And it's all become basically one big American frontier legend, one of our basic legends about how the West was won, how the frontier was settled, how we conquered, and we, you know, the white nation of America conquered the West, all together. And the story and the retelling of the story begins actually with Uncle James, with angry old Uncle James, because he writes a narrative of his 8 years of looking for his niece. A rather self-justifying little thing. And there's been many, many, many different accounts. There have been prairie operas and, you know, one-act plays. This was the subject of an election campaign biography at one point. Fictional stories, fanciful versions, you know, Texas history books, which are equally fanciful. And I will say, Comanche oral legend. And I will say this, that the Comanche oral history of this and the Texan official history of this are equally unreliable because they're written by people who have things they want to accomplish in these stories and they seek to accomplish them. And then, of course, eventually it becomes a novel and it becomes The Searchers. At first, Alan LeMay's novel, which interestingly enough begins that scene we saw, the second part of that scene in the farmhouse, in the ranch house, that's the beginning of the novel. And we can talk a little bit about why John Ford didn't choose to begin the movie that way. It was pretty powerful and pretty scary. Anyway, and Cynthia Ann's original story has joined this long list of what we call captivity narratives. Now I happen to agree with Spielberg and Lucas and Scorsese and Kevin Storr, I'm sure, and others, that The Searchers is one of the great American movies, certainly one of the great Westerns, but it actually finished number 7 in the Sight and Sound poll of greatest movies of all time a couple years ago, and I happen to agree. And we'll circle back to the film, the John Wayne and John Ford, in a little bit. But the purpose of all that research I did and of my book is to put the searchers in its historical context. It doesn't arise from nowhere. It doesn't arise even from John Ford's poetic imagination. There was a real story back there. The story had a life before the movie came along. And I think, and Ford and Wayne breathed new life into it and gave it another artistic sensibility and made it into something new and different. And The Searchers, though, is part of a long narrative chain. And I think this film, which is, for my money, the richest and deepest of American modern Hollywood cinema in any effect, becomes even richer and deeper when you know where it comes from and what happened to it along the way. So the captivity narrative, have you read any of those? Not that many people know of Mary Rowlandson, so I'm assuming not. It was really our first American literary genre, long before we were making movies, of course. People were writing captivity narratives. And Mary Rowlandson's account in 1682 of her abduction and the abduction of her three children by Narragansett Indians in Lancaster, Massachusetts, that's really our first homegrown bestseller in America. The notion of white women and children being spirited off to, you know, some dark, savage, barbarian wilderness by red men really inflamed and excited the colonial imagination in all kinds of scary ways. It's got lots of scary gender and sexual connotations. James Fenimore Cooper's classic novels of the 19th century, most especially The Last of the Mohicans, explores similar themes. The female captives are expected to maintain their purity somehow, even though they've been taken away by these guys, or die trying. And often, when they're returned to white civilization, so-called civilization, they're held suspect. They're even shunned because of the fear that they've been polluted somehow, spiritually as well as physically, by being forced to live with, and not to make too fine a point, forced to have sex with Indians. It's called, there's a term for it in you know, frontier history, it's called a fate worse than death. And Cynthia Ann Parker had to struggle with this legacy. She'd been dragged across this invisible border, if you will. She'd been taken from the white world, you know, into the Comanche world, and then dragged back again 24 years later. Her Texas relatives did not shun her. It's important to say. They were kind people, but they couldn't understand what was going on with her at all. And Cynthia Ann, interestingly enough, left no narrative. She wrote nothing. And there isn't even a decent interview with her, you know, newspaper interview with her from her time. She is relatively silent, which incidentally made it a lot easier for the myth makers because they didn't have to deal with any facts in terms of, so they can start right from scratch to describe or create what happened to Cynthia Ann during those 24 years, right? And I did my best to try to piece together what we could actually say that might be true from the firsthand accounts from the time, but I can't pretend that I know exactly what happened to Cynthia Ann. I don't. I can say that after she was recaptured and brought back to the white world, she was for a time a kind of mini celebrity. Her uncle Isaac took her before the state legislature in Texas, and they got her an annuity and a grant of land to pay for her care. She sat in the gallery, looking down at these white men, and they were all white men, on the main floor. She was dressed in a fancy outfit. Remember, looking very uncomfortable. I mean, remember, this was a woman who for 24 years didn't have any buttons on her clothes. And they've got her all dialed up and up there, and she's looking down at these guys, and she concludes, not wrongly, I would say, that they're actually a judge and jury, and they're trying to decide what to do with her and whether to hang her because she's a Comanche. And she's seen things and maybe done things, you know, to white people. So she looks at that and she runs away. She tries to run away and they have to drag her back there. And after that, after a brief time, she stops being a celebrity, if you will, and she becomes sort of an embarrassment to her white family. And they stop showing her off and they start to hide her. And she disappears from the public eye. There are no published accounts of her later life. There isn't even an obituary for when she dies. And in fact, it's disputed as to exactly when she died. You know, in recent years, she's been celebrated in Texas and elsewhere for her courage and her toughness. Even the Texas Monthly, which is a pretty good magazine and should know better, referred to her as the sort of prototypical feminist heroine. The original tough Texas woman, strong as buffalo hide, family-loving and high-spirited despite dire circumstances. But that's another embroidered myth. That's our myth, if you will. The truth is, Cynthia Ann wasn't the hardy survivor of tough times, you know, as much as the ultimate victim of the Texas Comanche Wars. She was abducted and traumatized by both sides. The experiences she went through doesn't feel like liberation, feel like captivity. You've got to remember what kind of war this was. You got just a little taste of it in the, you know, in the clip we saw. These aren't armies, right, on the battlefield fighting each other, people in uniform. They're not dropping bombs at each other. They're not using drones. It's not, you know, and when a village is wiped out or a family is wiped out, it's not like collateral damage. We're very sorry we killed your family. We didn't mean to. It's not like that. This is an intimate war. People kill each other looking each other in the face. You know, they're using guns or they're using hatchets or they're using knives. And women and children aren't like the inadvertent, you know, casualties here. They're the targets. They're what it's all about. The idea here is to wipe out the other side's culture, the other side's family. This is a, you know, this is a struggle between two nations, if you will. And one side's going to win and one side's going to lose. And the side that wins is going to wipe out the other side. And it was a 40-year war. It's the longest war that ever took place on American soil. And it was ugly, very ugly. I should say, one of the things I found in the archives at the University of Texas was an account of a Fort Worth schoolgirl being let out of school one day who saw Cynthia Ann at a local retail store back when they were showing her off a little bit. Here's the quote. She stood on a large wooden box surrounded by the curious spectators. She was bound with rope. She wore a torn calico dress. She made a pathetic figure. Tears were streaming down her face. This girl and the other school kids were let out early so they could go see the white Comanche. As I said earlier, she never saw her two Comanche sons again. And her daughter, whose name was Prairie Flower, died, most likely of typhus. We're not exactly sure when. For a long time, the legend was that Prairie Flower had died around 1864, and Cynthia Ann then was crushed by losing her daughter and died of a broken heart soon after that. But as I say, there's no obituary. And a researcher named Margaret Hacker came along in Fort Worth a few years ago and found a copy of the 1870 census. That would be 6 years later than that particular story. And Cynthia Ann's on it. So we know she lived that long. But we figure she probably died soon after 1870. The one saving grace of this very sad story is that her surviving Comanche son, as I said, Quanah, who took her last name after he surrendered. The Comanches basically ran out of steam in the 1860s and 70s. By 1875, Comanche power was crushed. And Quanah brings his folks in, and he becomes a rather heroic figure. He's not in the Searchers. John Ford is not interested in him, at least not in this film. And you talk about someone with two careers. I mean, Quanah spent the first half of his life as a, you know, a warrior out in the panhandle. How many of you have been to the Texas panhandle, incidentally? Looks a lot like Monument Valley, right? No, not so much. It's flat. It's very dramatic in its own sort of horizontal way. And it's a very tough place to make a living. Well, that was the first half of his life was as a raider and a warrior and a hunter. But after the surrender, Quanah manages to evolve into somebody very, very different very, very quickly. And as I said, he emerges as a force for reconciliation and adjustment. He seems to have grasped kind of earlier than other Comanches that things had changed and that there was no going back. And he becomes one of our great sort of American Western archetypes, the noble savage. The white Comanche. And he, in effect, is a storyteller also. And he tells the story of his white mother and what happened to her as a way of explaining what he's doing. and the fact that he's a force for reconciliation. And he makes friendships with wealthy white ranchers, and he cuts deals with people. And the ranchers pay him. People like Burke Burnett and Charles Goodnight pay what they call grass money so they can run their cattle through the Comanche lands in southwest Oklahoma. And he befriends President Teddy Roosevelt, and he takes Roosevelt wolf hunting in southwest Oklahoma. And at the end, you know, and Roosevelt takes a shine to Quanah and promises him at the end of this, that he's going to, that he, Roosevelt, is going to send buffalo from the Bronx Zoo in New York to Oklahoma, where there aren't any buffalo, where there were once millions of buffalo, but they'd all been wiped out. And sure enough, 2 years later, a train pulls up in Cache, Oklahoma, near Quanah's home, and 16 buffalo from the Bronx Zoo are there. And Quanah and his guys dress up in their old warrior outfits and get on their horses and take those 16 buffalo up to the Wichita Mountains, about 20 miles north of there. And if you go to the Wichita Mountain Game Refuge there now, it's a federal refuge, there are like 650 buffalo. They are the great, 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 great grandchildren of the original 16. There were only about 2,000 Comanches in existence at the time of the surrender. They'd been decimated by war and disease and mass extermination of the buffalo. And, you know, in many ways, it was more treacherous, however, for them to be wards of the American state than to have been enemies of the state, because their friends, their white friends, progressives, in some ways were, you know, worked hard to aid in their cultural obliteration. These folks believed that that for the Comanches to survive, they needed to become little white people. And they built Indian schools, the Fort Sill School, and a couple in Oklahoma, and the famous Carlisle School in Pennsylvania. And they brought young Indians there and cut off their braids, made them wear little white outfits, wouldn't let them speak Comanche, and certainly wouldn't let them practice any kind of Comanche religion, all in the name of helping them survive. And Quanah, through his compromises and his deal-making, helped prevent this from succeeding. He became the man to know, and the government recognized him as the official chief of the Comanches. Well, the Comanches had never had one official chief, and a lot of the Comanches weren't too excited about Quanah taking this role. Remember, they said he wasn't necessarily all Comanche either, right? He had a white mother. Anyway, by the time he dies in 1911, he's one of the best-known Native Americans leaders in the United States, and certainly the most admired. The obituaries in 1911 gush about his brilliance and his kind heart and what a great leader he was. And you know what they really like about him is he's half white. And they talk about that. That's their explanation for why he was so brilliant. He's a white guy. He's one of us, or at least partly one of us. As the red blood in his veins dominated in his youth, so the white strain began to show itself more strongly as the years passed. Okay. So the story of Cynthia Ann and Quanah gets told and retold, as I say, by each generation, if you will, and by Texas historians. It especially gets a big boost in 1936, which is the centennial of the original raid, but also it happens to be the centennial of the Alamo and of Texas independence. So that's a great time. And sure enough, and the state pays to rebuild Parker's Fort, where the original raid occurred, and it's there today. And you can tell yourself that that's what the fort actually looked like, but again, that too is a legend. It may be a little bit of what it looked like, but there's no way of knowing. Anyway, the Comanche side of the family comes down for the celebration, the Texan side shows up, and they reenact the original raid with the Comanches playing the Comanches and the white people playing the white victims. And also they serve Cynthia Ann Parker ice cream that a local pharmacy put together for it. So lest we think that we're the ones who have invented all the ways of commercializing the past, this is a great American tradition, started a long time ago. This is the American frontier reimagined. And that's constantly what Westerns are about, of course. We've been doing it a long time. A Hollywood screenwriter comes along, and a Western novelist. His name is Alan LeMay, and Alan is looking for a good story. He's up in the Panhandle. He's filming a B-Western that he's directing. He's really fed up with writing scripts because there's not much money in it, and you know, he's tired of working for other people. He had written almost a dozen novels that had done reasonably well, and he decides he's going to get back to that. And while he's up in the Panhandle, which is the center of really of what was called Comancheria, when the Comanches really were a dominant force, and he hears the story of Quanta Parker, and he hears about Quanta's mom, and he ends up going down to East Texas, to the area around old Fort Parker and Elkhart, Texas, and he starts asking people about Cynthia Ann and Quanta. Only it's interesting, he's not so much interested in Cynthia Ann, he's interested in her old, vindictive, angry Uncle James. And that's what he asks mostly about. And Alan starts, you know, he's a novelist, he's not an historian, but he's well versed in history, and he starts putting together a book, and he takes the Cynthia Ann story, and he takes 69 other captivity narratives from the West, and he starts smushing them together and doing some things to them. He moves the story up from 1836, when it originally happened, to 1868, after the Civil War. I think he likes the munitions a little better. The guns are a little more interesting after the Civil War. But also, the war between Comanches and Texans is coming to a head. So there are a couple of reasons, and it allows him to make a Confederate veteran out of one of his heroes. He has two searchers. He has the equivalent of Uncle James, but then he adds a fictional nephew to go along. And he adds, as I say, lots of elements from other captivity narratives. He serializes this in the Saturday Evening Post. It's called The Avenging Texans in its original version. And it gets and then it becomes The Searchers. And it does pretty well. And then along comes, finally, you know, when was I going to get to John Ford? Well, finally, we get to John Ford. Now, you know, as Kevin suggested, John Ford was one of those directors who made the jump from silent films, you know, to talkies, one of the few, really. The other important part of this is, from the beginning, John Ford was steeped in making Westerns. The first movie he directed was Tornado in 1917. It's a silent film. It's a Western. And he makes his own sort of grand silent movie, you know, The Iron Horse in 1924. He makes several others along the way. Ford, you know, he's mostly a forgotten figure now, obviously. People, you know, have heard his name, but they don't know much about him. The thing is, he won 4 Academy Awards for Best Director. Grapes of Wrath, The Informer, How Green Was My Valley, The Quiet Man. That's 4. That's more than anyone else has ever won. I think somebody's won 3. I'm not even sure. He also won 2 more for documentaries he did in the Navy during World War II. So, you know, he's recognized as one of the great, great figures. But what's interesting, when I rattle off those titles, none of those films are Westerns. The Western really wasn't considered, you know, an artistic form. It was a popular genre. And still, for Ford, however, the Western really was at the heart of his identity and of his interests. What was it that made it such a popular, enduring art form? I mean, you can read Kevin's book to find out most of that. But I would say, ultimately, it's the story that Americans liked to tell themselves about the making of America, right? What Richard Slotkin, a professor at Wesleyan University, calls an informing mythology. And that mythology tells us that we are a uniquely virtuous people who triumphed over great odds, you know, and we're forged, our character's been forged by this rugged frontier and by the enemies we had to defeat, and the values that the frontier instilled in us. It's why we're independent. It's why we're fair. It's why we're a moral people. It's why America is the greatest nation. It's a foundational myth, very similar to what other settler colonial societies. If you go to South Africa and you listen to Afrikaners, the white minority group that ran South Africa for so many years, they have a similar foundational myth. You know, Israelis have one, especially in settler societies where people go and have a conflict with the indigenous peoples. They create a story around it that they tell themselves, and it's always a good story. And John Ford was one of the people who really refined that story for Americans. By 1954, however, when the novel comes out, Ford is a very damaged man. He was a lifelong alcoholic, but at this point he's also got a bad gallbladder, and his left eye is so blurred that he's wearing an eye patch. over it, which is not a good thing if you're a director, you know. His beloved older brother, Francis, is dying of cancer. And the city of Los Angeles is about to tear down the house that John Ford and his wife lived in for 30 years because they're going to build a parking lot for the Hollywood Bowl that they're building over in that part of town. So he's a mess. He's on the first days of filming a movie called Mr. Roberts, which is a Navy comedy, you know, and on location in Midway Island. Again, Ford had been in the Navy. He was a retired admiral. He had good connections. He'd gotten things set up there. The star of that movie was Henry Fonda, who was Ford's favorite actor at that point, more than John Wayne. You know, everything's going to go great, except it's not going great. He's drinking. He's angry. He's unhappy. And the first day of filming ends up with him punching Fonda in the nose, literally. And so eventually Warner Brothers takes him off the film. He goes to the hospital. He gets his gallbladder out. Now, John Ford was a hard man and a very abusive man. And, you know, these days I think his friends would stage an intervention, right? But nobody intervenes, you know, with a guy like John Ford. Instead, his friends come up with an idea. They find this novel, The Searchers. It's really perfect for him in so many ways. And he sees that too. So he enlists his usual crew. First of all, he gets his old drinking buddy and protege, a young guy, well, not so young at this point, named John Wayne. Then he gets financing from a man named Cornelius Vanderbilt Whitney. That's Vanderbilt and Whitney. If you can put those two last names together, those are two of the biggest fortunes in American history. And this guy has a piece of both of them. And he wants to make movies. He wants to come to Hollywood. So they put together the financing. They sell the distribution rights to Warners. And Ford takes his company. Ford had stuntmen and wranglers and some of the actors who are not the stars, but the people who are in many John Ford movies. You saw a couple of them there. Dorothy Jordan, who plays the mother who does the slap, is the wife of Marion C. Cooper, who was Ford's business partner and producer. Cooper is also a famous guy for other reasons. You know, she's in a couple of Ford movies. You see some of these folks, and they appear over and over. And he takes them, and he goes off to Monument Valley, which, as Kevin points out, is his favorite place to do this kind of thing. And they make The Searchers. Now, as I said, I don't think any of you have been to Monument Valley. Doesn't look anything like Texas, that's for sure. But for somebody growing up in Rochester, New York, and I don't know, maybe for you in seeing this, it looks to me the way Texas is supposed to look, right? Dramatic and dry and, you know, and parched and scary. And Ford uses Monument Valley kind of the way Shakespeare used, you know, the Globe Theater. I mean, it's the place where he sets his stories. And I don't know if you remember, the first moment of the movie starts with this panel that says, Texas, 1868. And she opens the door, and we're in Monument Valley, right? I think that's partly his way of saying, folks, this is a movie, this is a story, this is a myth, this is a fable. You know, don't expect authenticity here. We're going to tell you a story. And incidentally, let me just mention briefly, he uses his in-house screenwriter, a guy named Frank Nugent, who'd been a New York Times film critic and then had gone to Hollywood and had failed, flopped for a while in writing scripts, but Ford hooked up with him in the late 1940s. Nugent was nominated for an Academy Award for a script for The Quiet Man, one of Ford's great films. And he sets Nugent to work on this. And I mention Nugent particularly because if you go to the Gottlieb Library here at BU, they have Nugent's papers. Not much on The Searchers, unfortunately. I spent a long time looking. But stuff about who Nugent was and how he wrote for John Wayne, for example. And you know, and John Wayne is the key to, you know, I mentioned earlier, they start messing with the story. They start changing things and reorganizing it. The novel begins with this shattering scene at the ranch house where this family is about to be attacked by Comanches. And if you look in Ford's copy of the novel, you see he's underlined parts of that, the birds that come flying out of the trees there. That's in the novel, and Ford's underlined it in the book. He wants Frank to put that in the script. But he doesn't start with this dramatic scene. He starts, if you remember, somewhere else, right? Remember where he starts? What's the first thing that happens in the story? Sorry?
Ethan shows up.
Yeah, somebody named Ethan shows up. It takes a while to figure out who he is. Well, we don't know exactly who he is, except he's clearly, we find out pretty quickly, he's the brother of Aaron and the brother-in-law of Martha. Why would you start there rather than with this dramatic opening? Any guesses? Well, let me put it a different way. Why would you start a John Wayne movie with John Wayne? That's why. I mean, that's part of why. And yet, if you read, Nugent's written about what Ford had in mind, and the idea of bringing in this new, somewhat mysterious element, this person, who the movie's going to be about. Because remember, this movie is not about Cynthia Ann Parker. It's not about Debbie. It's not about the abductee. It's about the searchers. And so it begins with one of them, with the primary person who's going to be the searcher. And this is interesting because the novel, in the novel of the two searchers, Marty, the younger guy, is really the center of gravity of the novel. It's really a story about Marty's evolution from a callow 17-year-old youth to an experienced backwoodsman. And Marty's on a moral quest because Marty's trying to get his sister, you know, his adopted sister back. He's trying to restore this family that's been shattered by this horrific event that our clip led up to, right? But in the movie, Ethan's the center of gravity. And that's partly because it's John Wayne, but it's partly because that's what really interested Ford the most. That's where we were going. They rename him. They darken him. In the novel, you know, maybe he doesn't really care if she lives or dies, his niece. But he's not out to kill her. He never draws that conclusion. But in the movie, something else is going on. And they take all those shadowy psychosexual questions that I mentioned at the beginning about captivity narratives and whether someone's had sex with Indians. And rather than make that kind of subtle and, you know, sitting there, they raise it right to the surface. It's the whole basis of what's going on, of what's driving Ethan forward after a while. Ethan is a dark knight, and he resolves not that he's going to save his niece, right, but that he's going to kill her. And he's going to kill her because she's grown into a young woman, and whether voluntarily or not, it doesn't matter to him, she's become morally, spiritually, physically polluted, right? She's had sex with Indians, in other words. And the only solution, the only honorable solution he can see for this is to kill her. It's like a, you know, an honor killing from Pakistan or somewhere. But here's the thing. Well, is Ethan happy about this? Is this, he wakes up one morning and says, got the perfect solution here. I'll kill my niece. He's not happy about it. It's a very difficult decision to come to, and I'm not sure, you know, whether he really decides that that's what he's going to do. But he doesn't know what to do. He's a man of violence. He solves problems with guns and fists. That's the way he gets through life. That's what he's really good at. He's a warrior. He's your classic American hero. You know, if you look at Kevin's book, you see all the, you know, exactly laid out there what the classic American Western hero is supposed to be. And there's Ethan, you know. The good, bad man, instinctive, intuitive, you know, armed, warrior, you know, solitary. That's Ethan all the way. And yet, in The Searchers, there's a little more going on. And at the heart of this, I should add, is John Wayne. And I don't know how many of you have seen John Wayne movies over the years. You know, for people like me growing up with John Wayne, I think my image of him originally was of this kind of chubby guy with the toupee, pro-Vietnam War, you know, sort of macho-driven kind of person playing the same part over and over and over again in the 60s and the early 70s. And, you know, but before he was that, he was something else again. There are some good later movies, don't get me wrong, but he had his own film company, he was paying the directors. When John Ford was working with him and when Howard Hawks was working with him, he was somebody else. He was a younger, more svelte, interesting guy. And he created a range of what I would say distinctly American characters and a persona that's rather unique. He fits in very well with the people from James Fenimore Cooper's novels and with our Western mythic heroes, both fictional and nonfictional. And he creates this persona that has charm and menace and physical grace, someone you rely on. Remember when Ben in that clip says to his mother, she says, "What's the matter, Ben?" Well, what's the matter is the Comanches are about to surround us and kill us all. But he says to her, I just wish Uncle Ethan were here, Ma, don't you? Well, in that circumstance, we all want Uncle Ethan to be there. We all want John Wayne in that ranch house with us, right? Because he's going to defend us and because he's good at it, right? He's very hard to kill. Wayne didn't invent the parts he played. He didn't write them or anything, but he invented the man who played them. He invented a movie star named John Wayne. And he possesses, as I said, all of the manly virtues we expect in our Western heroes, right? The sort of dark charisma. But he's tainted in this movie by racism, and he's crazed by vengeance. As I say, he's going to go out and kill, you know, a girl, you know, a young woman. I mean, he's darker and angrier and more troubled than he was in any other part he ever played. Still, because he's played by John Wayne, we identify with Uncle Ethan, you know, even as we recoil from him. He's sort of our Captain Ahab. And the man behind all this is John Ford. He's the storyteller. He's a guy who helped. He didn't invent Western myths, but he really brought them to the screen in a way that they hadn't been done before. And he told it better and more artfully, really, and especially in the Cavalry trilogy in the late 1940s. But as he grew older, I think Ford more and more embraced complexity. And so he gives us our Western hero with all the tropes that go along with that and the characteristics, and then he starts to undermine him, right? He starts to undermine this myth. He reaffirms our conventional wisdom, and then he eats into it, because our Western hero is also a psychopath who's going to kill a young woman and who does a lot of crazy-ass stuff. And I think that despite all of his personal setbacks at this point in his life, that Ford really rose to the height of his own creative powers as a movie maker here. The film is full of visual poetry, and I'm not just talking about the beautiful scenes of Monument Valley. I'm talking about his ability to swivel from being out, you know, from being in these sort of intimate ranch house settings, and we saw a little bit of that, right? Where, you know, domestic settings with family life, people on the edge trying to hang on, trying to create some kind of community, trying to stay alive in these intimate little interiors, and then he can swing the next minute and we're out in Monument Valley, which is this incredible gothic sandstone, you know, place that's been there for millions of years, and where human beings and relationships between human beings are like, you know, this big. And he's able to take us from the darkness to the light and back and forth and capture all of that. And that's, if you, you know, it seems simple in a way, but if you watch movies made by folks who are wonderful filmmakers but not very good at Westerns, I'm thinking of John Huston especially and another Alan LeMay novel that he filmed called The Unforgiven, you can see that this isn't easy to do, and Ford does it beautifully. I spent a lot of time in the archives at Indiana University where Ford's papers are, looking for notes, looking for him to explain what he did here, and there's very, very little. Ford hated to talk about this stuff, and he wrote down even less. And so in the end, when you study The Searchers, the only way really to figure out a lot of what he's doing is to compare Nugent's final shooting script, which you can get online, incidentally, with what's actually in the movie. And you find out there are a lot of things different. But the most important thing is that almost every time where Nugent, it's a great script, it's one of the, you know, and yet Ford's constantly ripping things out of it and eliminating stuff. And you see what he's doing is he's eliminating dialogue and exposition, moments where the characters explain themselves. And he's leaving it to visual. He's just telling the story visually, and you have to decide why the character does what he does. So, for example, is Ethan in love with his sister-in-law, Martha? What do you think? Seems pretty clear, right? Is Martha in love with him? So in the novel, just so you know, the uncle is in love with his sister-in-law, but she doesn't know about it. She doesn't know. There's no, you know, she's oblivious to it. They make it richer and darker by making it go back and forth. And the big change, and again, everyone's seen this movie. I'm not spoiling this for anyone. All right, is the ending. Because in the script, it explains exactly why Ethan doesn't kill her. He takes out the gun, he points it at Debbie's head, looks her in the face, tells her to look away, but she won't. She looks straight at him, and he says, "You sure do look a lot like your mother." And he puts the gun down, and he takes her home. So there it is, Frank Nugent's explanation. And I think they filmed that at Miami Valley. I don't know for sure because, you know, it's infuriatingly hard to figure it out. But I don't think Ford wanted it. And Ford refilms it when he gets back to Hollywood. He takes him out to Griffin Park, which is in Hollywood, and it's a place where a lot of filmmakers did a lot of work, fix-up work or cheap work over the years. It's still there and still used for things. And he films the ending that we saw, that we see. That's the ending of the film. And you have to decide, we have to decide, why Ethan doesn't kill her. Now, you know, some people will say when you look at that wonderful scene when they're in the, when Marty and Ethan are seeing the captives who have been recaptured by Custer's 7th Cavalry, and they're all kind of weirded out, right? They've been crazed, the young women who have been recaptured from the Comanches. And there's this wonderful moment. The only other time, Ford moves that camera forward twice in this movie. He moves it forward when you saw it, when he moves into Lucy's face when she's screaming, and when her mother slaps her in the face, camera moves forward into her face, and it happens again with Ethan at this scene when he's hears some of these captives crying out, and people have interpreted that as the moment when he really resolves he's going to kill Debbie because he sees that these captives have been destroyed somehow and that they're no longer human in the way he calculates it. And I'm not so sure about that. I've seen that face, that expression now about 25 times. Not clear to me, but it's not supposed to be. John Ford's leaving it to us. And I think this ambiguity in the storytelling and this use of visual narrative and the avoidance of making it very clear to us exactly why these people are doing these things is what takes The Searchers and raises it from a very good John Wayne Cowboys and Indians movie to a piece of cinematic art. Searchers was rather overlooked at its time. It got pretty good reviews. It did pretty well in the box office, number 11. But it was seen as just pretty much a pretty good John Wayne movie. Nobody really focused on the gender stuff, the racial stuff. They just kind of let it pass, right? And it's really taken another generation or two for people to really adopt it. And it really became the forerunner, I think, of a whole generation of introspective Westerns. Postmodern, call them what you will, which include Ford's own The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance, which I think is his last great Western, and a very rich film if you haven't seen it, to The Wild Bunch by Sam Peckinpah, to Clint Eastwood's movies. I think all these movies give you parts of the Western myth and then begin to dissect that myth right in front of our eyes. And all that starts with The Searchers, in my view. Ernest Hemingway once said that all modern American literature comes from one book by Mark Twain called Huckleberry Finn. And a film critic named Stuart Byron said, in the same broad way, we can say that all recent American cinema derives from The Searchers. So a lot more we could talk about, and let's talk about some of it. But I'm going to stop here. I just want to paraphrase, though, something that the film critic David Thompson once said about this movie. David Thompson's not a big Ford fan, but he really loves The Searchers, and he's seen it many, many times. And he says he finds it so unsettling that he's never sure how it's going to end. Now, you know how it ends, and I've seen this movie. I must have seen this movie now 40 times, and I know exactly how it ends, of course. But at the same time, I think I understand what he's saying. It's just that kind of thing. It upsets all of our assumptions. How does it treat Native Americans? Terribly, right? In a very paternalistic at best and racist way. They're barbarians, they're murderers, they're rapists. I just want to paraphrase the way they treat, look, the one sympathetic Comanche figure, the young woman who inadvertently seems to be married to Marty at one point, and the way they treat her. And yet at the same time, there are things there where we begin to see what's motivating the terrible, evil Comanche warrior scar. it's complicated, it's unsettling, it never sits still, the searchers. It never allows us to kind of just embrace it and say, yeah, I'm comfortable with that. There's nothing in there that I'm comfortable with, except how it ends. Anyway, thank you very much.